As you can see, Sinclair has taken over my channel. But don't worry, they're not going to force me to read a political statement, because I'm not talking about Sinclair Broadcasting, I'm talking about Sinclair Research. The electronics company run by Clive Sinclair, which had a range of popular and inexpensive home computers from the early to mid 1980s. This video is not going to be an in-depth historical overview of Sinclair and these computers, because I already have a video about this machine, which I did a couple years ago. So if you're more interested in the technical details of this computer, I'll include a link in the description to watch that. And there are other videos about these machines as well. And of course, Wikipedia and books as well. Although I do not recommend this one, because even though it says it's the only book you'll ever need to become an expert at the Timex Sinclair 1000 and 2000 computers, this is the print equivalent to clickbait. What this book really is just a reprint of the owner's manual combined with a lengthy and very boring technical tutorial of basic programming. Let's start with these two computers. They may look identical, but they're actually not. For the sake of brevity, I'll call this one the ZX81, and I'll call this one the ZX81. That's because this one is the British version and this one is the American version. This model was introduced in the UK in March 1981 at a price of £49.95 British pounds for a kit you had to build yourself, or £69.95 British pounds for a fully assembled machine. And in November 1981, as maybe you can read by my cheat sheet here, it was released in the US at a price of £149.95 for a fully assembled machine, or $99.95 for a kit. And it was available through mail order from Sinclair Research in Nashua, New Hampshire, or you could get it through the American Express catalog. That's back when having a credit card was still a little bit of a luxury. So American Express would send a catalog to their cardholders of all the fancy items you could buy using your card, and this was one of them. And even though these two machines look identical, there are actually some slight differences. For example, on the British version, the backspace key is called rub out and the enter key is called new line, while in the US version the backspace key is called delete and the enter key is called enter. And if we look at them from the side, the British version has the TV RF output towards the rest of the jacks, while the US version has it more towards the back. And both of them have a little knockout plug in the plastic molding where the opposite jack would have gone. So clearly they're both using the same molding. They just switched the position of the RF output. And underneath there are some more differences. The US version has an FCC identification data listing it as model number ZX81 USA. And it has an RF channel output switch for channel 2 or channel 3, while the UK version outputs only on what is British UHF channel 36. The American version also has additional metal shielding inside it in order to meet FCC standards. When I first got this British ZX81 and did a video about it a couple years ago, it was a mystery how this ended up in the USA, because it came with a ZX USA RAM pack and US literature referring to Sinclair Research in Nashua, New Hampshire. Well, thanks to this American ZX81 that I just got on eBay, I think the mystery has been solved, because it came with this sheet here with important information, and on the back it has special additional instructions for USA kits. And it says kits may be either UHF or VHF. It says for UHF kits, tune your TV somewhere between channels 30 and 40. And it also says UHF kits may have the English terminology new line and rub out on their keyboards instead of enter and delete. So apparently if you bought a kit version of the ZX81 in the USA, they may have sent you the parts for a British ZX81. And since it was sold as a kit, it didn't need to meet the FCC standards, because you built it yourself. They didn't build it for you. And it just so happens that British UHF channel 36 has the same video frequency as American UHF channel 34. Now the color and audio subcarrier frequencies are different, but that's irrelevant because this computer doesn't have color and doesn't have sound. So all you needed to do to use this computer from American TV was to tune it to channel 34. And back when this was new, every TV had a manual vertical hold control, so it was no problem to adjust it for the 50 Hertz refresh rate instead of the 60 Hertz that American TV signals use. The ZX81 turned out to be popular enough in the USA that Sinclair entered into an agreement with Timex to sell it at any retail outlets that were selling Timex products. So pretty much anywhere you could buy a Timex watch, you could buy a Timex computer.
Now, Timex brings the power of the computer within reach of more people than ever before. Introducing the Timex Sinclair 1000, the first of a new generation of computers designed to be easier to use and to own. For $99.95, power to learn at the speed of light, power to organize with unfailing accuracy. The Timex Sinclair 1000, power is within your reach.
So they turned the ZX81 into the Timex Sinclair 1000, and they also upgraded the RAM to 2K, while these two only have 1K built in. But otherwise, aside from that, and also the name change, this is pretty much identical to the US ZX81. And you could still buy these through mail order even after the Timex version was introduced. So while this was introduced in July 1982, at a price of $99.95. A month later, in August 1982, Sinclair lowered the price of the US version of the ZX81 to match it, or you could get a kit for $79.95. So let's unbox this Timex Sinclair 1000 personal computer. It says the power is within your reach. So let's unbox this thing. There goes the box falling on the floor, and there is the styrofoam with Timex Sinclair 1000 engraved into it, which is nice. And here is the computer itself, and we can put it side by side with the American ZX81. And you can see it carries over the same terminology of using enter and delete instead of new line and rub out. But other than the logos being changed, it looks identical. Still has the TV output towards the back, although there is no knockout plug for where it would be closer to the middle in the British version. So maybe by this time they did change the molding. The FCC ID looks different. Made in Portugal. Still has that channel 2 or 3 switch on the bottom. Has the serial number sticker towards the back. We get a 90-day limited warranty. We got our owner's manual. Copyright 1982. Looks like they slimmed it down, actually, because if you compare the size, it's like half the size of the ZX81 manual. And the ZX81 manual is even bigger. It's even spiral bound. So it looks like they simplified it a bit. And we have our RCA cable for connecting it to the switch box. And also includes the AC adapter, which, interestingly, the Sinclair version actually says Sinclair on it. Well, this one was some third-party brand. DVE, that was a rather common brand. I see that name on a lot of AC adapters that came with computers and video games from this time period. So there are the three door stops side by side by side. The ZX81, ZX81, and Timex Sinclair 1000. And even if you added all three of them together, These days, probably even your coffee maker has more computing power than these three machines. And just for a sense of scale, here they are compared to a standard full-sized PC keyboard. And all was well and good with these computers until January 1983, when what was going to be the Timex Sinclair 2000 was demonstrated at the Consumer Electronics Show. It was going to be introduced at a price somewhere between $150 and $200. And it was pretty much just an Americanized version of the Sinclair Spectrum. That was Sinclair's first computer with color graphics and sound, and it was a massive success over in the UK, but here in the USA there was a lot more competition. In fact, within just a few months after they announced the Timex Sinclair 2000, the TI-99/4A, Commodore VIC-20, and Atari 400 were all selling for under $100. So Timex knew they couldn't compete with that kind of pricing, so they canceled the Timex Sinclair 2000 and introduced a stopgap, the Timex Sinclair 1500. So what Timex did is they took the case of what was going to be the Timex Sinclair 2000 and they repackaged the 1000 into it. So the same old ZX81, ZX81, Timex Sinclair 1000 circuitry they put in this case. And they also included the 16K RAM built in, although you could still use the RAM pack to expand it to 32K, as it says right there on the box. So this was introduced around July or August of 1983 at a price of $79.95 US dollars. So for about 20 bucks less than a Commodore VIC-20, Atari 400, or TI-99/4A, you can get one of these. In glorious black and white with no sound. It says, nothing so smart was ever so simple. And indeed, this was a very simple computer for 1983. Let's see what they say on the back here. Powerful 16K expandable memory to use hundreds of software programs. One-touch keyboard entry, a typewriter-style keyboard. Yeah, I don't think so. They mentioned the little dot matrix printer you can get, or a modem, or a growing software library of instant load Timex command cartridges. Yeah, I don't think they actually released any of these, or at least not very many, because you had to buy this special add-on just to use them. It says copyright 1983, Timex Computer Corporation, made in Portugal. So let's unbox it. This time the box is engraved Timex Sinclair 1500. And there it is, with its rubber dead flesh keyboard. You can see the size comparison to the Timex Sinclair 1000. So it is quite an improvement in terms of being able to type on it, but still nowhere near as good as a proper full-size keyboard. This time all the connections are on the back and there is no channel switch because it automatically defaults to channel 2 when you turn it on, or if you press the number 3 key within a few seconds after turning it on, it'll switch to channel 3. And even has a little cutout of where the Spectrum has its built-in speaker, but this has nothing because it doesn't have any sound capability. I don't have quite all the accessories and manuals for this one, although I do have the original demo tape. And what appears to be the cassette cable with plenty of styrofoam stuck to it. So here's the complete lineup. The British ZX81, the American ZX81, Timex Sinclair 1000, and Timex Sinclair 1500. And just for some more context on the pricing of these machines, I have this Timex Sinclair Horizons newsletter from December 1984, which means it would have been put together maybe a month or two before then. And this article comparing the Timex Sinclair 1000 to the Radio Shack TRS-80 Model 100 portable computer. The author of this article mentions he got his Timex Sinclair 1000 the previous Christmas, that would have been 1983, at Kmart for $30. for a brand new computer in 1983, and he mentions the 1500 was being sold as of when this was written for $75, and the original price of these 16K RAM packs was $49.95 each. Well, this newsletter is an ad selling them for $12 each. And as for the canceled Timex Sinclair 2000, which was going to be the Americanized version of the Sinclair Spectrum, Timex went back to the drawing board and completely redesigned the machine with a totally new case, with a better keyboard, joystick ports, a cartridge slot, better sound capability, composite video output, more RAM. They called it the Timex Sinclair 2068. And they introduced it in November 1983 at a price of $199.95. But the problem was, by that time, you could get a Commodore 64 for the same price. And with all those changes Timex made to the Timex Sinclair 2068, it was no longer compatible with Sinclair Spectrum software. So if you bought one, you had virtually no software available for it, other than a few dozen titles available directly from Timex. And if you compare that to the hundreds of software titles and games available for the Commodore 64, Timex just couldn't compete, and by the spring of 1984, they abandoned the computer market entirely. It also didn't help that these machines became the butt of jokes due to their limited capabilities. As you can see in this commercial, comparing the Commodore 64 to the IBM PC and the Timex Sinclair 1000.
Some people buy an IBM personal computer to manage their finances, but after spending $1,355, what finances are left to manage? Others think one of those tiny computers will do. Fine, for storing a few phone numbers and recipes for Nestle Road Pie. There's a choice between spending too much or getting too little computer. The Commodore 64 gives you as much memory as the IBM at less than half the cost.
A few years ago, I actually had a Timex Sinclair 2068, and I briefly showed it in one video, which was completely unrelated, but ultimately I never got around to making a video about that computer because I couldn't find any software for it. Once in a while you can find some software on eBay for the 2068, but it's very rare, and usually the sellers are asking like $30 each for one piece of software, which is just ridiculous. But Modern Vintage Gamer did a video about the Timex Sinclair 2068, and he showed how you can modify it to improve its Sinclair Spectrum compatibility. Even though Timex gave up on selling computers, meanwhile, Sinclair soldiered on. Independent of Timex, they introduced an Americanized version of the Sinclair QL, as you can see here in this magazine newsletter. Said the price was going to be $499. So this actually was sold in the US, although they didn't sell very many of them. And the only other Sinclair computer, which I've not mentioned so far, which was sold in the US, was the original ZX80, or again, what the British would call the ZX80, which was briefly sold here. You could get it fully assembled for $199.95. I doubt very many of those were sold here, but they certainly do exist. So that's my overview of Sinclair and Timex Sinclair computers from a US perspective. If you want to see these computers in action, see my original video about the ZX81, in which I demonstrated the British version, or what you could call the ZX81, in operation. And otherwise, all these computers are functionally equivalent, just with the minor differences I pointed out. They all run the same software, program BASIC the same way, so there's no real difference in terms of operation between them. These computers had much longer lasting popularity over in the UK. Here in the US, most people probably just used them for a few months until they outgrew them and put them back in the box and stuck them in a closet for 30 years, which is probably why it's still so easy to find these in the original box. And I believe Commodore, for a while, had a promotion where if you traded in one of these, you would get a rebate off the price of a new Commodore 64. And these days, if you pay more than $40 for one of these, complete in the original box, you're paying too much. Except maybe for the 1500, just because of its rarity. So these are not exactly valuable collector's items, but I'm still happy to have them. And they're small and light enough that you can even hang them on the wall and use them as a decoration. And due to their wedge-like shape, they make an excellent doorstop.